And we are live. Hello, everyone, from sunny Sacramento here. The Philippe Matthews Show live, coming to you around the world on Google Hangouts. Excited to be with you. This show is brought to you by Fat Jerry's Philly Cheesesteak. You know I love my cheesesteaks, and I love Fat Jerry, too. He's a great guy. This show is brought to you by Fat Jerry's Phillies. And I'm excited today to have with me Suzanne Mathis McQueen. It's an incredible book, and I know that we've been promoting this to a lot of women, and a lot of women might think that this is just for them, but really it's for guys too, and we're going to talk to you as to why that's important. Suzanne is a certified peace ambassador and a trained indigenous ceremonialist for women's circles. She is the carrier of a stone healing bowl, gifted to her by Lakota Way, which she brings to her gatherings for her water blessing bowl ceremonies. She's also a former salon owner, which we're going to talk about that. I think that's interesting, and hairdresser, who owned two salons before building actually the first largest day spa in Ashland, Oregon, which is her hometown, I believe, and co-founding a private facial licensing school, which I think is absolutely cool, because I'm into the whole skincare and all of that beauty stuff, metrosexual stuff. And she was honored with the Business of the Year Award in 2000 and was past president of Women's Entrepreneurs of Oregon and a former mentor for Southern Oregon Women's Access to Credit. Now, so what we're doing now is kind of setting this up to qualify her to really write this book that is really her own personal journey. The name of the book that we're going to be talking about is Four Seasons in 4 Weeks, Awakening the Power, Wisdom, and Beauty in Every Woman's Nature. How are you, sweetheart?
I'm just great. Thank you so much for having me today, Philippe.
Oh, I'm excited. I'm honored to have you. And let's just get right into it here. I was reading your materials, of course, reading the book as well, and realized that this was a book that was kind of told to you by a friend, a male friend, that you should write. You thought you were going to write it in a couple of weeks, and it actually took 7 years.
That's right. Yeah, very much so, right.
Talk to me about how this book came about. Why did you do it, and why did it take so long for you to do it?
Well, first of all, it was a book I never planned on writing because it was just something that I really didn't want to talk about. I mean, I never thought in a million years that I would be promoting the virtues of the female cycle or any of the women's hormonal rhythms as a way to reach equality and enlightenment and personal empowerment, but that's exactly what I'm doing. At the time, though, I just never wanted to do it. This was something that I discovered for myself back in the late 90s, and it's a practice that I saw the accuracy of, and I practiced it myself for 7 years before this guy friend of mine said, you have to write about this because I get it too.
Well, I think that's pretty enlightening. That's an enlightened guy because he gets it too. Let's talk about that aspect of this. But before we do that, where did the title come from? I think it's an interesting title and an interesting process totally. But where did the title come from?
Well, the title is, you know, I mean, I probably had about 1,000 titles that I kept going through, and nothing was sitting right. And somehow this one just hit me because it's exactly what it is. I break down the approximate 28 days of a woman's hormonal cycle into 4 guided weeks that I call fall, winter, spring, and summer. Because mm-hmm. as women, what I say is that we go through these 4 seasons in a month the same way that men go through these 4 seasons in a year. This is also, I just want to put out right now that this is an imprint that we have as females from the time we're born until the time we die, but surfaces during our reproductive years to show us the blueprint of this imprint that we have as females and this rhythmic rhythmic way of being that we haven't really been taught.
What did you learn in those 7 years that it kind of took you to put pen to paper? What did you learn about yourself as you were going through this self-discovery process?
Well, what I discovered is that actually when I got into alignment with these energies within my cycle. So, you know, in a very broad way, we have these four phases, and within those four phases are four energies. And when I would align myself with these energies, I was thinking more clearly, I was making clearer decisions, I was really feeling in my core power, and just had a lot more happiness and just a surety about who I was and where I was going.
Okay. You talk about in the book, there's obviously seasons, but you also talk about moon phases and archetypes.
Right.
Speak to us about that, and how does that come into play?
Well, let me break this down for you so that you get it, so that everyone can relate to it.
Okay.
What happens is that every universal rhythm has something that looks like a resting phase, a building phase, an expression phase, and a deconstructing phase, and back to rest. Okay. Every living thing on the planet has something like that going on, and the female rhythm, monthly rhythm, is no different. We all have it in a 24-hour circadian rhythm. So we all sleep at night. We get up in the morning. That's a building phase. We peak at some point in the day, and then we wind back down at night, and we're back to rest. And sometimes we do that a couple times during the day. But we all have this 24-hour circadian rhythm, and we make different decisions based on what our energy is like. If we're tired at night, we're not necessarily wanting to take on a big challenge, solve a big decision. You know, we say we want to sleep on it, you know, that kind of thing.
Sure.
We all make different decisions based on our energies throughout the day. And so, again, women have this same profile, the same rhythm throughout a month's time. They're also showing, scientists are now starting to show that men hormonally have that same pattern, but throughout a year's time. So, in other words, what we have in a week, you would have in a three-month phase. So women have, through this monthly time, the first week could be the resting phase, the second week is the building phase, the third week is the expression phase, and the fourth week is the deconstruction or problem-solving phase, and then back to rest. Men would have a three-month period of more of a rest, and what I mean by that is that once we rest, it's when our best ideas are coming. It's the time we're sort of ruminating over things, and we're in a planning stage. Mm-hmm. The second 3 months for men would be taking those ideas, and now you're building on them. Let's just say it's a business, and so now you're taking action on those ideas that you had in the first phase. So the second phase, you're building. The third 3 months would be like, okay, it's going. We've got it going on. You know, we're feeling pretty, you know, pretty good about all of that. Mm-hmm. And then the fourth phase, the next 3 months, would be like, shoot, okay, we've run into some challenges. Let's do some problem solving. We might have to go back to the drawing board for a couple of these things. This is working. That's not working. And you're kind of working things out. It can also be a very low time, kind of a depressive time. Maybe you're losing some direction, don't have any direction. There's a lot of light and shadow in all of these phases, but then it's back to the next phase. So in other words, you know, the way that I see it is that men follow the sun, women follow the moon.
Mm, so, I like that.
But we have to go through this in a month's time, because we are, whether we still have a womb or not makes no difference. As females, we are wired with this moon rhythm. And so this resting phase would identify with a new moon, second phase would identify with a waxing moon, third phase would identify full expression with the full moon, fourth phase would identify with the waning moon, and then back to rest or back to new moon again. And that ends up following fall, winter, spring, and summer in this particular system as well. Because the thing is that the characteristics of all of these phases have a lot of similarities.
Sure.
And I only use them as symbolism. I only use them as a way for women particularly to identify and remember how to get in sync with these energies, because otherwise, to be honest, we have just been, I mean, we all know we've been living in a man's world for a very, very, very long time. And for generations upon generations upon generations, women have had to learn how to live in this man's world. So they've been actually sort of doing the men's rhythm, sort of having to do this steady burn, which is not natural for them. And when women are out of alignment with their natural rhythm, sometimes they just don't know why they're unhappy. But they just aren't quite in sync, and because society has laid on us that well, we're just a mystery then, and we're just crazy. Mm-hmm. That causes depression and sadness and, you know, an inability to get out of poverty at times. You know, all kinds of things that continue to happen in the world. For women, I find that if they can really start understanding that we've just been cut from this umbilical cord that was ours as female, and really tap back into that language and culture of our natural rhythm, we start mastering this reproductive body of ours. Again, whether somebody still has a womb or not doesn't really matter, because there are issues around all of this that are very secretive and shameful in a way. You know, they live underneath the surface. And so when women can actually understand and know themselves better, really understand this rhythm, I mean, it's kind of a miracle.
This is really for all women. I mean, it's not just for women who are cycling. This really is for all women, whether they're menopausal or not, which we'll talk about.
But
it's really for, you know, ages, you know, 8 to 80. I mean, literally.
And I say even from the time we're born.
I would
like to see us start having little girls track, maybe at about 5 years old. If we help them, the parents, if we had them start tracking actually on the new moon, just to give us a way to do it, and just have them track their physical energy, just so that they can just start, you know, seeing what it's like, they'll probably start to see the patterns a little bit as they start to rumble into towards adolescence. And then by the time they hit adolescence, the idea of being rhythmic and understanding that their energies are going to move around in a predictable way, actually, is going to be very helpful by the time they hit adolescence.
Okay, this is fascinating. So let's talk about the menopausal woman.
Mm-hmm.
This practice, how does it differ from women who are on a cycle?
Cycling. Well, what happens is that now everything has settled down a lot more. And what happens is that most of the time in our society, even though we've had a lot of information on menopause, the truth is that our society treats women as if they're finished at menopause. And so women sort of believe that themselves because their hormones, everything mellows out. I mean, we lose them. And so what happens here is that women just believe it, and you can just see that they feel invisible. What happens, though, is that as women, we're wired for this rhythm. And if you talk to a lot of women who have been aware, they will tell you that rhythm is still alive and well. It's not as big as it was, but it is still very much there. So I have women track, just like the young girls, start tracking by the first day of the new moon. We all used to cycle as women by the moon, by the light of the moon, but once artificial lighting came in, then that blocked those signals and kind of messed up our own body signals there. But the moon is still very powerful, but really it's not so much that they are cycling by the moon. It's just that this gives them a way, if they start tracking at the new moon, it gives them a way to tell their body to remember what it knows so well because it cycled for so long.
Mm-hmm.
And then it helps them to, as a matter of fact, some of my postmenopause women are the ones who give me the most amazing feedback because they just can't believe it. They just can't believe it. But it's absolutely accurate.
Well, I'm loving what I'm hearing. One of the questions that has come up is, how do you, how would men or, you know, how would a couple, but men in particular, begin the conversation or introduction of this book or introduction of this process to their significant other?
What has to happen is that in the book itself, I'm writing this book first and foremost for women because it's really women's to own and to identify. This whole template that I lay out is very, very broad, but it is based on the scientific hormones, the landscape of the scientific hormones. But the woman, once she's tracking, needs to, you know, over time, really start understanding what her uniqueness is within her cycle, within her rhythm. And she can share that with her partner. Because what happens is that this is, again, a logical, predictable sequence that men can understand very easily and are understanding very easily. Men have the greatest questions ever. They see a rhythm, but they just don't know what to do with it. And so when this is laid out, they just think,
well, most men run.
I totally get that. Yeah. And the thing about this, though, is that the difference is that, well, some men have said, oh, well, you know, women are a mystery. I'll never understand them. And, you know, and I say, well, you know what? Yes, you will. And if you really want to be the best lover, And if you really want to co-create the best relationship that you can, you know, that you desire, then I suggest that you take a look at this, because it's very easy, and it shows men how to be successful at being supportive of the woman in their life. And if mama ain't happy, ain't nobody happy.
Amen, sister. Yeah. So this is really great. Now, how can this cycle and being in tune with these phases improve? I mean, obviously, I would assume it would improve every aspect of a woman's life, whether it's their health, their beauty, their sexuality. Talk to us about what are those phases, and how can that help in various different aspects of a woman's life?
All right, great. And business, for sure.
And business, absolutely.
And the reason why that's on my mind is because that's exactly how I fell into tracking my cycle. I owned this large day spa. I had a staff of 30. And I felt that I was doing a really good job at putting the vision out there and disseminating the information. We had a phenomenal, you know, business, the whole thing. But I found myself making inconsistent decisions. And nobody complained about it. Nobody else really noticed
it. Give me an example of it.
So this was a day spa, right? Mm-hmm. And we would have these staff meetings, and we would have this ongoing issue about how to get the clients in and out of the steam room after their massage, because we had this very small steam room that was really only meant for one person or two or three people that were together. But, you know, we were busy, and so we kind of had this traffic jam going on, and, you know, we had to figure this out. And every time we approached it, and I would be talking with the massage therapists about it, because they were the ones having the challenge, so it would be up to them to ultimately, you know, say what they needed. And but every time I approached it, I feel like I'd walk away from it where I had put a different opinion out there a little bit, or kind of taken a different stance. They were all fine, but I would find myself coming from different directions, a way that I hadn't been thinking about it before. Now, that may not sound unusual because you're coming up with new ideas, but I'm really talking about, you know, kind of how I, you know, what I was drawn to as far as a real solution, which wasn't like me. I've got this very logical mind. I see things visually.
It's kind of like waffling back and forth a little bit.
I was waffling back and forth. And I don't like, you know, I've not been someone who ever thought that my hormones had anything to do with what made me tick. Again, I just didn't like the reputation out in the world. I didn't like what was coming at me as a female. Sure. I didn't like what was going toward females. So I resisted. But I, at this particular time, I thought, you know, it just hit me. I think I need to track my cycle and see if I can get any sort of insight at all. And I tracked for a couple of months, went home on a lunch break from work, and I was standing at my kitchen counter eating a sandwich, flipping my day planner, and looking back over my notes. I just made notes about my physical energy and all that stuff that I talked about. And it just hit me. It was a huge epiphany, and I just saw the entire thing. I saw exactly how it all worked. I knew exactly what it all meant, almost like when you're in a dream and you know what something means.
So it was a big aha moment.
The big aha moment. And so I mapped it out, and I started doing this practice, and it just blew my mind how incredibly accurate it was. It was this navigation.
Would be a part of this book then.
What's that?
I say journaling would definitely be a part of this book, a part of this process.
Absolutely. Tracking is everything. Tracking is everything, but not in the way that women have been taught to track, which I'm also in favor of, which would be a fertility awareness method practice or something like this, where you're actually where that's the biology. You know, when we're tracking the biology of the cycle, usually for conception or contraception, for those particular reasons, we're tracking in a particular way. What I bring into this scenario, what they're tracking for, is really their psychological experience and also the primal wisdom of what's actually happening with this cycle. And there is just so much information, and that brings us to your question. And your question was, you know, how does this help women in all of these different phases of their life, their health, and so forth?
You talk about three tribes of women in this book.
Mm-hmm.
What are those three tribes, and how does that relate to the process?
So it's back to the girls. I have these very raw names for them that, but I think it's very, they're very primal names, but they are the reality of what we experience as women. So I call our girls our pre-bloods. They're not on their cycles yet. And then there are the blood givers, and those are the ones that are cycling. And then there are the blood keepers, and those are our
post-menopausal. This sounds like that sounds like characters in the movie Blade or something, right?
Yeah, they do. Yeah. They
Vampire Diaries, right?
Exactly. But the truth is that, again, this whole life of blood is something that is a real secretive existence for women. It's this underground existence, and we all know what it is as women, you know, but it's still not talked about amongst women all that often, but it's certainly not talked about with the men.
Sure.
But it's a reality of our day-to-day, our moment-to-moment existence at times. I mean, we may be running a Fortune 500 company and have horrendous cramps, or, you know, there are all these things going on in a woman's life that nobody knows about. And it's not that this book is out to really talk about those things all that much. What I'm bringing out is really helping women to understand that they're not alone, and that there is a rhyme or reason to what is happening, and they can help to balance out what is happening in there by understanding these four phases. Because this rhythm of ours is a navigational system, Philippe. It is a remarkable navigational system. And what happens, may I give you an example of how that works? The first phase is a resting phase. Our hormones biologically are laying low at this time. They're at their lowest. And what that means is that women need to lay low. They need to be sleeping. They need to be resting. They can go to work. You know, this is not an illness. They can go run a marathon if that's what they've scheduled to do. But the idea is that they're more mindful about what they do afterwards. They don't go do that extra errand. They do not go out for pizza and beer after the marathon. They need to be mindful about going home and resting, because when women don't rest, it's no different than you or I not resting, not sleeping at night, you know. And I don't know about you, but I could do it for one night. You know, I could do it if it's a great New Year's Eve or something. Right. It better be a good party, right?
Yeah, it better be.
Better be worth it.
There's going to be some prices to pay the neck when I wake up.
That's right. And if it's two nights in a row, forget it. I'm trashed for days.
Absolutely.
I mean, you know, it's just not happening. Well, women aren't resting, and it's messing them up for the rest of the month, and they're stressed out, they're overworked, and oftentimes, you know, they're just doing it all.
Well, so, let's go back for a minute on that, because let's track back just a bit. When you were talking about your business, mm-hmm. What are the best time in these moon phases? When are the best times for good business decisions and business acumen and productivity? What are the best times for, you know, the best sexual experience, the best intuition? Do you track this and have those aspects laid out?
Very much so. First of all, let me say they're all great times. It's just a matter of knowing how to compensate for it. And what I mean by compensate is that we all compensate. If it's cold outside, what do we do? What do any of us do? We put on a jacket, right? So that's compensating for the cold weather outside. So women, what this system does is it shows women how to compensate for whatever is happening in one of these energies. So, but ultimately, we're looking at, as reproductive women, as that blueprint, we are construction zones. Every single month, we are building a uterine nest to prepare for a pregnancy, should we desire one, and if nothing happens, that nest has to come down. Every single month, we build a nest and we deconstruct a nest over and over and over again. So there's the rest, there's the building, and in that building stage, we are really great at pulling all the stuff together for the business, you know, really making things happen. We are networking. We want to do it all during the second week. Mm-hmm. You know, through all of these weeks, again, I'd like to bring the male aspect into it, our partners, because this is an important piece for the men also, as far as seeing how they can best be supportive and so that they can understand this. So If you don't mind, let me back up for just a second.
Sure.
For the first stage, this resting phase, the best thing that the guy can do is, because she needs to be resting, he needs to be really cool about the fact that he needs to encourage her to be mellow. Okay, you know, honey, you know what, after we get home from work or whatever, I want you to just chill out. I'm going to make dinner, or I'm going to bring some dinner in. We're going to watch a movie. You know, this is a great time for you, too. This is an internal time for both of you. It's a very sweet time. She may want her feet rubbed. He needs to follow her lead on sexuality. You know, what are you both comfortable with during this time? This is the time she's on her period. So, but he needs to encourage her to rest. And I'll tell you, that is like one of the coolest things a guy can do. It is such an aphrodisiac. Women are sexual inside and outside of the bedroom. Everything's sexual to them as far as, you know, whether they are, you know, they're just so turned on by just the sweetest acts. Mm-hmm. And so something like that sets up a couple in the woman's mind in such a great way. So after rest, this is also, the best time to get the best visions and things like that. But for the man, it's a great time to just be supportive. When they go into the second week, now her hormones are going from 0 to 100. And that's because she's building that uterine nest. And what's going on, the primal wisdom underneath the surface of that, is that she's trying to attract a mate. So she wants nothing more than for her guy to show up and want to be with her. Okay, so I tell the guys to clear your desk, clear your calendar. You're going to go on dates. Go play. Go have a great time. Ask her out. Plan a dinner. You know, if money is a big issue, there are so many things you can do that are just sweet and fun and playful. It's a super romantic week. Super romantic for her. She's sexually intoxicated. Mm-hmm. And, mm-hmm. I mean, this is what's happening primarily.
Her hormones are going like crazy.
Her hormones, her estrogen and testosterone have kind of got this little cocktail going on that's making that happen. And so, but she wants to do it all. She wants to connect with everybody. She wants to connect with all her friends. She wants to build her business. She wants to build her love in her life. And she really wants to attract her mate. Of course, you can see how there can be a shadow side to this if you don't have a mate. I mean, you can come into some depression or sadness that you wish you had one and you're not finding the right one. Maybe you're unhappy in your relationship, and maybe this is the time that you get the most depressed, because primarily this is the time when your body wants to be feeling its best and wants to attract the right mate. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there can be a lot of conflict going on underneath the surface that she has no idea is going on. Maybe she has no direction, even with her business or her vision for her life. Her body is feeling like, come on, let's go, let's make this happen. And she's feeling like, I have no direction. I don't know where I'm going. And that causes some sadness. Again, she doesn't even know this is happening, because this is a primal thing that's going on underneath the surface.
This is biology, absolutely.
This is biology.
Yeah, yeah. This is absolutely fascinating.
This is primordial biology. You know, this gets down to it. And as the end of this week goes on, she is becoming more and more beautiful scientifically, biologically. In her beauty, she is actually becoming more beautiful because she's attracting that mate. And she feels good. So I'm telling women to, you know, like, you know, try something that you've been wanting to try. Throw some rollers in your hair if you've wanted to do that, you know, it's not who you are normally. Do it this week. You know, do some things that are fun. But this is absolutely the most romantic week. This is the time to, make sure contraception is in place. I'm going to say that. Last week and this week.
Sure.
If you don't want a pregnancy, then you've got to get the contraception that works for you down. But I encourage couples to just turn on their best lovemaking. Have heart-to-heart talks. Heart-to-heart talks are super important during this week. Again, this is a real aphrodisiac for women when their guy will actually, and it can't be BS. Women have strong BS monitors. Okay? So,
yes,
you know? So, you know, it needs to be real. But sure. And it really helps the men to have a safe place.
I would also say, not to interrupt you, I would also say that a man who is willing to get in tune to their significant other to this degree is probably the highest form of showing love.
Oh, it's kind of unbelievable. I mean, you know, it's like the best thing that can possibly happen. She just feels incredibly honored, and you know, and it doesn't have to be a loud thing or anything. It just has to be just you get into the rhythm together. It's kind of like a really good dance, you know, and you just know it and you feel it. And when the woman feels that, it's just such a relief. Then she's actually free to really enjoy sex as well, because otherwise, if she's got a guy who's just coming at her with the steady burn, with the same thing all the time, after a while, she's saying no to everything, even though she might want to say yes this time, but that means that she's got to say yes next time. And, you know, her body, this is a whole other layer of the whole thing, is what her body is actually doing. What's going on in the womb makes a difference in what's going on with how she likes to be touched. And so that's a whole conversation, too.
That's another, that's probably another show.
That's another show. But I do talk about it in the book. I very much get into it in the book on how these different body parts are related to the womb. And so what's going on there either makes things stimulated or not stimulated.
Sure. Now, these archetypes that you talk about, the queen, visionary, art builder, fun date, lover guy, talk to me about that and how that meshes with these phases.
I use archetypes simply because it's easy to identify with and helps. Okay. All of this is all about symbolism for the purpose of helping the woman understand how this rhythm goes, and also helping the man understand how this rhythm goes. Mm-hmm. And then she may end up discovering, you know, switching out my archetypes for something that's her own. And it makes no difference. Someone may relate to the seasons the way that I use them. They may not. It doesn't matter. The whole idea is so that they start feeling this rhythm and start knowing that they can wake up in the morning or any given day, a woman should know what day she's on and what that means. What that means with her energy, what that means for compensating, for really mastering her rhythm. It's kind of like surfing. You know, if you have never, if you don't know how to swim and you get thrown out in the ocean, then you're really, you're drowning and you're overwhelmed and you feel upset a lot. Mm. Once you start understanding this ocean, starts feeling pretty good, and you start tackling these little waves. If you are in there enough and you're shown and you're given some examples and some tools, pretty soon you're going out to the bigger waves, and then it becomes an exhilarating ride. You're not getting clobbered. Well, once in a while you might hit your head on a rock or something, but you know, this is not going to be perfect. This is our lifetime of a rhythm. I mean, we every day we've got, what it really helps us to do is that when challenges come up, that we have the tools to know how to handle things. The third week of this particular rhythm, the first day is ovulation, and ovulation relates to the full moon. Okay, so the couple has done all their great lovemaking. The full moon, the first day of ovulation, I mean, Philippe, this is the most primal and the most spiritual thing in the universe. Mm. I mean, think about it. You know, an egg and a sperm coming together, that's, again, it's back to primal, primordial stuff.
Sure.
And it's the most spiritual thing that could possibly happen. So,
What should the couple do during, or what should the man do, and what should they do together in that phase, in the full moon phase?
In the full moon phase, as long as they've done well in the first week. See, this is all building upon each other.
Sure.
So as long as they've done, and it may take a few cycles to kind of get good at this, because you got some things to work out. You can't expect everything to happen right away.
Okay.
But let's say you've had a sweet time the first week, the second week you've gone on dates, you had your heart-to-hearts, you're in love with each other, you've had a great time, you've made some good love. On ovulation, my thing, I just say it's raw, it's primal, get down and dirty, do some, try stuff you've never tried before, be ridiculous, have some laughs, and it's just, this is full expression, this is full moon, this is the moment of truth, of showing who we really are, and are we telling the truth of who we are? Are we expressing to the world who we are, or have we only been making our family happy our whole life? Mm. Have we been playing a role that is not making us happy because secretly we have a whole other persona going on in there? You know, and so it helps us month after month after month. This is such an opportunity to be able to see, to shed those layers that we don't need anymore. Mm-hmm. But it gives us a chance to say, am I really presenting? And if you've got a partner and you are intimate with a partner, then you really are showing up, you know, here I am. And is this really, are you really expressing your real true self and who you really are? It's such a great time to be self-evaluating and growing.
Now, I can only imagine that when, you know, when this book came across my desk, I just basically said, oh, I've got to do this show. I've got to have you on the show because I think this information is just absolutely vital for not just the sake of women's health and emotion and empowerment, but for coupledom, you know,
yes.
For relationship. Obviously, the book is replete with all of the information necessary and needed for a woman and for a man to, if you will, get into the rhythm.
Yeah.
But I would only assume that some women, when they put the book down, will say, "Hey, I want more. You know,
yeah.
I want some personal coaching, counseling. Where is Suzanne going to be? I want to talk to her personally and see her personally." Do you have any other coaching process that you use other than just the book?
I do. I have, well, first of all, the most basic piece is that I have a daily tracker and journal that I also printed. And so if a woman is interested in proceeding, then she should get that and start tracking. But personally, as far as coaching goes, I have a live retreat coming up here in Oregon on June 10th through the 13th, which should just be really, really great. And that's on my website. I also have a 13-week online course coming up at the end of June. And that will be a cycle tracking course. It's a little over 3 months, but I really want the women to, as a group, to it really takes about 3 months to sure. really, you know, really be seeing that. So I wanted to coach them through the 13 weeks there.
And do you have something for men as well in your coaching processes?
Not yet, but I will. What I hope to create this summer. Or a couple, same thing, yeah. I would like to do both. It's just, as you know, it's a lot to pull together these courses and have them just right. But people can also come and do a one-on-one day with me here in Oregon, and I will coach them individually. But I'm going to be creating a course for men that will probably be a self-paced course on my website, and hope to have that happen this summer. And then I'd like to get into coaching, consulting with couples this fall.
Oh, fantastic.
Yeah.
How can, obviously people can get the book from, Amazon, Barnes and right. Nobles, what have you. How can people find you and get in contact with you, get on your email list, and start getting this fantastic information? It's maybe some one-on-one coaching.
Thank you. If they go to my website, 4s4w.com, and they can go and pick up a free poster. I mean, it's a digital download, you know, so they would need to print it out. But it separates out these four phases for them to see the energy of these phases. So it's the resting phase, the building phase, you know, the expression phase, the deconstruction phase, week one, week two, three, four. And so they get a free poster if they go on there. Just put your email in there and you'll get your download.
Fantastic. Yeah. You really obviously want to, in reading this work, really want to help empower women. I mean, it's just, not to say overkill, but I mean, you really went there and left nothing out. And it's a really powerful process. And I am going to introduce it to my sweetheart tonight. So we're going to have dinner and we're going to talk about this. Again, for women who are not in relationship, or women who are dating, who are trying to find "quote unquote" Mr. Right or versus Mr. Right now, what should they? Because some women do go through a great deal of depression, during that second phase, as well as the full moon phase. What can they do to mitigate that? Because they don't have that significant other, that relationship, that tenure, that really can only be applied in a long-term relationship or an intimate relationship.
Right. Well, the first thing is that any woman, whether she's in a relationship or not, as far as I'm concerned, needs to be tracking, because this is just simply information that we never learned growing up.
Sure.
And any of us, all of us need to get in there. All of this is really first and foremost for ourselves. This is the most important piece, that when we get into alignment with our rhythm, and I do want to repeat that the woman, as she tracks, will continue to hone it to so that she understands her own unique rhythm. This is a very broad template that I start with to guide her, but then she's got to start honing it herself, and she will start seeing that as she starts seeing the patterns. So as her, as she feels more empowered in that way, and we're talking about women who already feel pretty empowered. I was a very empowered woman when I came upon this, I thought. And I just didn't realize that this was the missing piece to my personal empowerment that I didn't realize wasn't even there.
Now, so some women though are grumpy and you know, catty and just, you know, hypersensitive during this time. By tracking and by following these phases and applying the principles that you promote in the book, will that alleviate that? Will they become, I guess, in a sense, more calm, more in tune?
Well, first of all,
also a biological thing in temperament.
Well, first of all, I think what you're talking about is actually the fourth week. So the thing that we normally think of as PMS, and I get rid of the idea of PMS altogether, except for the women.
That's
who
why
are
I didn't use the word, because you don't like
yeah.
it. So
yeah.
I didn't use
yeah, yeah,
it,
yeah.
so bring it up.
No, it's cool. Thank you. You presented that beautifully. I appreciate it. What happens here, and so I call this week the firewalk, because this is really, for me, a ceremonial time. And, you know, you introduced me. I'm a ceremonialist. And so I've gotten so that the reason why I've gotten into ceremony is because it gives us an opportunity, a way to sort of process things. I mean, you know, people have been doing ceremonies forever. You know, if you have a particular church that you go to, most likely it's got a lot of ceremonies. And one of the reasons that it's used is because it helps people to really go there. It helps people to open their hearts and to really kind of put things in perspective. So this fourth week, what it is biologically now the body has figured out that it's not pregnant. And when that happens, it has to deconstruct that uterine nest. So we're back to looking at the primal purposes here. And so what happens when it has to deconstruct the uterine nest, that means as women we lose our feel-good drugs. Estrogen and progesterone are feel-good drugs. Estrogen is already dropped after, it starts dropping after ovulation. But progesterone's been hanging around a while, because if the body's pregnant, the progesterone's going to hang in there and be sort of like a nanny for this, you know, for this growing baby. But yeah, it's not needed, so it leaves, and progesterone's a really nice hormone that just makes you feel good. So when we lose that, what happens is our body starts breaking down and getting ready to purge the following week in the form of the period. So during this week, it's kind of like you can relate it to being in labor. If the woman had been pregnant and then she goes into labor, it's preparing itself to birth. And we don't call labor a syndrome. We understand the process that this is a lot of radical stuff going on. Mm-hmm. So, and the woman doesn't want to be touched a lot. She doesn't necessarily want you blowing in her face when she's in labor or, you know, mm-hmm. whatever it is. Mm-hmm. But the same thing on a smaller scale is what's happening during this fourth week. The body is breaking down now, preparing to shed this lining. And that process is super radical. The hormone, the good feel-good hormones leave. And what really happens in this week is that the woman is really, I consider her to be in survival mode. What mm-hmm. happens here is that she has to get rid of what no longer serves her physically. I mean, whether she wants to or not, that's what her body is doing, with or mm-hmm. without her. Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's all breaking down. So as she's releasing, and I have women start paying attention to that. What can you let go of that no longer serves you emotionally, mentally, even people in your life, perhaps?
I love this language. This is great.
You don't take action right then, but you start being aware. And And but why she's also in survival mode is because she's also hanging on desperately to her values and principles right here. As everything is washing away in this huge tsunami that's going on, basically sort of her body's sort of rumbling and breaking down, she has to hang on to the things that, that mean so much to her. So any threat to her livelihood, any, you know, if there's a money issue going on and something major happens in the house right then around money, she's not a happy camper because this threatens not only her survival but her children's survival, possibly her marriage, you know, whatever, her family. You know, it's really mama bear mode. And so she's hanging on. Women really are the center of the circles as far as I mean, if we really got into, and this is a real generalization, and some people won't like this, but I see it that women, I just observe this, women are the circle makers, they're, you know, the family makers, and it's great when the men will protect those circles of what women create. And so when she sees her circle breaking down, whether it's her herself, her family, her community, or her world, you know, you have a fierce warrior on your hands,
sure,
who is justified in that way. So what I teach women to do, though, is to identify the first moments when she feels like she wants to burst into tears or yell at somebody, because what happens is that so much is trying to come out of the body, push its way out. It is basically literally on edge. It feels like everything is trying to push its way out. So too much stimulation coming in is just too much.
Sure,
And sometimes she sets herself up earlier, the week two, when she loves everybody, she sort of gives it all away. So I actually find that a lot of times the solution for her fourth week challenges are actually in the second week, that she needs to actually be a little more mindful in that second week about not doing everything for everyone, and then being frustrated that fourth week that they don't know how to do anything, you know. So
I like that. That's brilliant.
Yeah.
That's brilliant. Again, how can people get in contact with you, Suzanne? Just your website. Now, you have also Facebooks and Twitters too, right?
Oh yeah, I've got Facebook, Twitter. I'm on Facebook all the time. I profess to not being as much on Twitter as I would like. I just can't seem to resonate with it as much. But I'm a Facebook freak and have a lot of friends on there. So please friend me on Facebook and go to my Four Seasons in 4 Weeks Facebook page and like it. I would love that, please. And my website is 4s4w.com. Please go to the website and pick up that free poster. It'll just show you the four different phases. That'll get you started. And if this work resonates with you, I'd love for you to get the book. I would love for you to join me in any of the online courses that are happening. There will be a whole lot going on over this next year. I mean, I'm just going to develop one thing after another because
sure,
this work is resonating, and it's resonating all over the world. And I couldn't be happier to help women find a way to get into that core power. We need that, and when women are in their core power, everybody benefits. The men
absolutely
in their lives benefit, and the children benefit.
Absolutely. Suzanne, this has been so enlightening, so empowering. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Philippe.
I know you're busy as I don't know what, so I really appreciate that you took the time out of your schedule to Google Hangout Live with me here on the Philippe Matthews Show, and I'd love for you to come back, because you've got a lot of stuff to talk about.
There are a lot of layers to this thing, and I would love to come back, Philippe. I so appreciate you inviting me on today.
You're most welcome. And so, ladies and gentlemen, this has been another wonderful edition of the Philippe Matthews Show Live here on Google Hangouts, coming from you from sunny Sacramento. We have some phenomenal guests that are coming up. Stay tuned. You'll get all of the emails and information. Of course, you can go to thepmshow.tv to get all of the information and access to our shows. And that's it, ladies and gentlemen. So we're getting ready to stop our broadcast. Be blessed. Be prosperous. Enjoy the rest of your week. God bless.